Hi, I'm James Goodale, and you're watching The Digital Age. The issue tonight is whether the press has given Bush a pass. And here to discuss that issue with us is Mark Crispin Miller, a noted media critic, and who has written a book called The Bush what is the name of it?
Dyslexicon.
Dyslexicon. Do you think I'm dyslexic?
No. No, I think I might have chosen the wrong title.
It's a great book with lots of humor stories. We'll get into it in a minute.
Okay.
Part of your thesis, and as I said, you're a well-known media critic, is that the press has not been covering Bush as well as it might. And you start off your book, in part, by talking about the press coverage of the election, 2000 election.
Right.
What did the press do on that?
Well, the press did a shockingly biased job of covering that race, and a shockingly trivial job of covering that race. The coverage had nothing to do with any issues. It had nothing to do with the background of either candidate. It had nothing to do with the political vision of either candidate. All it really had to do with was Al Gore's stiffness and George W. Bush's folksiness and his occasional gaffe. In other words, what the coverage of the race had to do with was purely televisual concerns. How did either candidate come across on the tube? That's all it was about. It was an extended exercise in a kind of fifth-rate TV criticism. But as far as actually discussing what the candidates were capable of, what they were likely to do, where they'd come from, there was almost none of that.
You said that when I read your book, that actually Gore won the election and the press didn't cover that at all.
Well,
did Gore win the election?
Gore did win the election.
He won the popular vote, but he won the election in Florida. Isn't that what you're talking about?
That's a very good question considering what we're discussing here. The press has, contrary to what we often hear, mainly from people on the right, the press actually has a right-wing bias, by which I mean that it tends to be soft on the right, generally speaking. Now let's use this as an example. After the election was settled by the Supreme Court, all the major dailies and the network news divisions were very, very loud and insistent in saying that Al Gore should throw in the towel. He should do the gracious thing, he should do the dignified thing, he should throw in the towel, he should give up. As if it were for the media to decide in a democracy who gets to be president. There was a laborious recount process, as we all know, and the research organization that finally meticulously went through all the ballots in the state of Florida.
That was a press connected group.
Yeah, the National Opinion Research Center was basically hired by a consortium of major media.
Right.
So the long-awaited results came out after 9/11. And now hear this.
I'm listening.
The results were that Al Gore won the vote in the state of Florida.
I don't understand that. Look, I'm an ordinary reader of the New York Times.
Right.
I mean, I guess I glazed over like the rest of the nation. I thought I read the story very carefully, and I came to an opposite conclusion. Do I have dyslexia?
No, you don't. You're blameless. Okay. And I wouldn't blame the victim. The good people who read the New York Times and who watch the network news have indeed been victimized by coverage that was really nothing but spin. The article that very carefully set out the results of the study, actually, if you read between the lines, you could see that Gore had won the vote in the state of Florida. But it was such an agonized rendering of those facts in the New York Times.
Yeah.
They were trying so hard to spin it otherwise. Yeah.
Why do you think that was? Apparently the press didn't want to say Gore won because...
Well, because that's a very good question. Why throughout the contest did they consistently shy away from important stories pertaining to Bush and jump all over Gore for being wooden? Why did they not, for example, tell the truth about Bush's military record, that he was AWOL for the last year of his Texas National Guard service? This is a matter of fact. I'm not speculating.
You mean in fact AWOL or AWOL?
He
didn't show up.
He left.
Yeah.
He just stopped going.
Yeah.
And there's no evidence that he completed his service. the same press system that was always very quick to cover Clinton's draft troubles,
right,
and to acquiesce in the characterization of him as a draft dodger,
right,
was very, very tactful with George W. Bush. There were the Harkin business that has come to light since Enron was already a story during the election campaign, but way out on the margins. The mainstream press ignored it. There's example after example of this kind of thing, Jim. Now you ask why.
Well, let me just put off the why again,
okay,
because there are some other stories that you talked about in there that are interesting that I want to talk to you about that you said the press hadn't covered. There is a group known as the Carlyle Group.
Yes.
Now, the Carlyle Group is a group that does leverage buyouts, that has George W. Bush as a partner. It's got James Baker as a partner. And it has, therefore, contacts throughout the world. And in your book, you say the press hasn't covered really what the Carlyle Group is about. What is it about?
Well, the Carlyle Group has a lot of interests in national defense. The Carlyle Group stands to make a great deal from the war on terrorism. Most interestingly, there's the fact that the Bin Laden family owned a piece of the Carlyle Group.
And that's never been published, has it?
Only by the Wall Street Journal.
The Wall Street Journal
covered this. No one picked it up on TV. The New York Times ignored it. Shortly after the Wall Street Journal covered it, the Bin Ladens prudently sold their share.
Oh, they did?
Yes. But I point this out in the Bush Dyslexicon as simply one example among many of a remarkable blindness on the part of the corporate media. Just ask yourself this question. What if it had been Clinton? What if Clinton's father had worked for a firm like this?
I've got some other ones here, too.
Shoot.
Okay, so you have in your writings, I guess, maybe post your book, been critical of the way the press has covered Iraq and also the way it's covered Bush and Iraq.
Can
you tell us why? But tell us what.
Yeah, I'm glad you asked me this question. I have been, you know, a media critic for many years, and I've always taken a dim view of the performance of the American press. But I have to say, only lately have I been genuinely shocked by the things that our media system doesn't report. For example, a few weeks ago, when George W. Bush was standing up at the podium in Crawford, Donald Rumsfeld at his side, saying, "I'm a patient man," said this impatiently, "I'm a patient man, and we will consult and we will deliberate," that got covered everywhere. But no American media outlet, not a single one, covered the fact that on September 6th, the Allied attack on Iraq had already begun.
Well, explain that.
Well, 100 jets. British and American jets, 100 jets attacked the largest air defense installation.
Now, where did you pick that up?
From the Daily Telegraph in Britain, from Guardian in Britain, from the BBC in Britain, from the Independent in Britain, from the National Post in Canada. In other words, these press outlets in countries that don't have a First Amendment, right?
I've done better.
Much better.
Okay, well, let's do one more.
Sure.
Okay.
I got a million of them.
I know.
Sad to say.
We'll do one more.
Sad to say, yes.
Why have they been covering this dyslexia lately?
Oh, well, they actually have. First of all, it's not entirely clear that he's dyslexic, and I want to make clear
to your viewers.
Well, the dyslexicon, the dyslexia in the title, as I argue in the book, actually refers to the media system. See, a dyslexic person has a hard time translating written symbols into sounds. My argument is that whether or not Bush himself is dyslexic, as I think he might be, what's of much graver consequence is the fact that the media system just refuses to read the writing on the wall. Take Bush, for example.
Right.
Throughout the race, and since, as I demonstrate in the book, it's in black and white, from his own lips, the guy was patently unfit to be president. He didn't have a clue about what his own positions were. He was short-tempered. He was unclear. It was an abysmal performance. But the official media.
I'm not necessarily agreeing with that.
I understand. But the official media took a very different view. They consistently misrepresented him, as they still do. To this day, Jim, newspaper of record and other sources will actually correct his grammar and syntax when they run his quotations.
Can you give us an example of that?
Oh, good Lord, there are many examples.
Well, one was, I think, in your book that he said gooder, and they changed gooder to good.
That's actually a myth. He didn't.
Oh, it's
that's
a myth.
Not in the
didn't
book.
Know that? Well, do you have it? I mean, this book is full of dyslexicon. What examples? Is that fair to say? Now that I really fully understand your title, can you tell tell us of any of them?
You mean things that he says that are just. Yeah. See, what I argue in the book is not that George W. Bush is stupid.
Right.
I don't think that that's true.
Right.
I think he has severe intellectual limitations.
Right.
But I also think he's very cunning, very shrewd. His problem isn't stupidity. His problem is insincerity. He really blows it when he's speaking off the cuff. Only when he's talking in a key that's foreign to him, when he's trying to feign emotions that he doesn't really feel. When he tries to sound like he cares about the have-nots. See, that's when he'll say, I know how hard it is for you to put food on your family. See, that's when he'll say that. Or when he tries to feign altruism and he'll say about Afghanistan, we're freeing women and children from incredible impression. Okay? Now recently, and this was so egregious, the press actually picked it up, he tried to say, fool me once, shame on you, fool me twice, shame on me. He got into the middle of it and he went to pieces. He could not say, shame on me. He ended up quoting the Who. He said, won't get fooled again. You know, he just kind of shifted. Now, people laughed at this as they always do because, oh, that George Bush, he's such a dope. That's not it. See, when he talks about capital punishment, when he talks about getting revenge against Al-Qaeda, when he talks politics, when he talks baseball, when he talks about the things that matter to him, and when he cracks his jokes, which are invariably nasty, he's perfectly clear syntactically and grammatically. This is not a problem of stupidity, in other words, see? This is a problem of a guy who can't fake it, really.
Well, there was a lot of coverage of this sort of language use and what it meant during the primary. And perhaps some at the beginning of his presidency, but I asked you just a few minutes ago, and I ask you again. We don't seem to be getting much reportage on his syntax the way we used to.
Well, no, since 9/11, there's been a tendency on the part of the press to treat him as another Caesar. This was understandable, I think, right after 9/11, because the nation was shocked and reeling, and they wanted a president who was another Churchill. It's less understandable that it's persisted, though, because the shock has worn off for most people, and his actual ratings are slipping. But the media in this country really does function like the media did in the old Soviet Union, or the way the media does in Iraq. Often, if you read the daily transcripts of what Bush says, he is now more incoherent, I mean, really kind of frighteningly incoherent than ever. Especially at a time when he's expected to come across with powerful arguments for war. He's not making any sense.
Well, let me
and the media, you're right, is not taking note of this.
Okay, now I would suggest perhaps the media is doing this because of 9/11, because they don't want to be participants in presenting an image that would make the country feel insecure and uncomfortable. And therefore, they're going to give it a pass.
Well, I would agree with that if it weren't for one thing. The media has no qualms about engaging in the grossest alarmism. That you know, they don't mind making people feel uncomfortable and uneasy when it comes to showing Al-Qaeda's footage of the dog dying of poison gas, or when it comes to anthrax scares, things like that. They don't really want to keep us calm. They want to stay in good with the administration. They're too close to the administration.
They want to stay in good with the administration?
Absolutely, absolutely. The media system belongs to a cartel of enormous parent companies that stand to gain a great deal from deregulation. So I think that has much to do, not everything, but much to do with the reason why the corporate news system has been so ostentatiously favorable to this guy.
Well, your writings are full of what I would call the cartel theory. Not so long ago, you ran an article in The Nation in which you had diagrams and charts.
Done several of those, actually.
Have you done several of those?
Yeah.
Do you really believe in this theory?
It's not a theory. It's actually a fact. That is to say that we have seen our fourth estate become absorbed into a kind of entertainment slash news behemoth that isn't competitive. Also, one whose component corporations are losing money hand over fist. They're heavily indebted. You know, that's, for example, why...
They're not losing money hand over fist. They're heavily indebted, but not losing...
Well, they're not doing well. They're not doing well. They're losing audience share all the time.
Okay. Well, what are you talking about, actually?
Well, for example, their newscasts, the music industry, you know, book publishers. You know, I mean, they... For the first time in history, we have the same companies owning huge pieces of every culture industry. That's new. Even book publishing, you know, magazines, music, film, TV, radio, same companies, right? That sounds to me very like a cartel. It certainly is unprecedented, and my argument is...
Well, let's,
let me just finish,
Sure.
Is that it's very, very bad for democracy, because a system that is excessively fixated on the bottom line and that wants to curry favor with the federal government, with the White House,
right,
is not necessarily going to tell the American people what the American people need to
know.
Well,
in order to make, when I think that anyone can look at the chart and see a lot of agglomeration in the media business, but don't you have to make a connection between that fact and coverage? And has not always been the difficulty with this type of theory? In other words, you can show that Disney owns ABC, Disney owns a book company, Disney owns this, Disney owns that. But can you actually show that because of that, you can point to ABC's coverage and show that it's been tilted?
Oh, you can.
How can you do that?
Well, for example, there's the fact that Brian Ross of ABC News did a hard-hitting story about the problems at Disney's theme parks, like pedophilia among the staff, things like that. The show was spiked because ABC is owned by Disney. It wasn't spiked because it was a bad report.
Right.
And there are many examples of this kind of thing. That's one way to answer your question.
Well, a spike, but that's not your main point, is it, spiking?
Well, it has a lot to do with it.
Yeah.
Stories get killed because the owners don't want them told. I think that's a pretty clear symptom that something's wrong. But there's also more of a structural thing. When these owners take over, they want two things from their news divisions. On the one hand, they want very titillating stories, so you get your Princess Di, your John F. Kennedy Jr., your Monica Lewinsky, but they also slash news budgets to the bone, so there's no funds for real investigative journalism, and what this gives rise to is the shouting heads syndrome, so different from what we're doing here, by the way.
I'm being very polite. I used to shout, but you're mesmerizing.
No, we're having a civilized conversation, and there are issues involved that we care about, but the 24-hour cable news operations, you may notice, are all opinion, all screaming. It's very cheap. You know, it doesn't cost
that
much.
But isn't that...
So I'm saying the economies of scale here are working
forced,
in the wrong direction.
Forced the news in the wrong direction.
Yeah.
But isn't CNN a great wonder of
not
the
for a long
current,
time.
Current situation?
CNN?
Sure.
No, I think CNN's shockingly bad. I think CNN is...
Well, what's wrong with having a lot of opinion?
Well, there's nothing wrong with having a lot of opinion as long as some vital information gets circulated and as long as the opinion is not used to prevent people with divergent points of view from speaking out. Let me give you an example from CNN. Scott Ritter, you know, who was the chief weapons inspector in Iraq and who has been strongly critical of the Bush-Cheney war plan, has valuable things to say, agree with him or not. And the guy's no flaming Marxist. I mean, he's an ex-Marine and a Republican. He has precise technical reasons why the claim that Saddam has these vast arsenals of weapons of mass destruction, that claim is iffy. When he's appeared on CNN and when he's appeared on MSNBC, he's been vilified. He's been interrupted. He's been accused of treason. Now, that seems to me to be, at best, a grossly unprofessional way for journalists to behave.
How would you do it?
How would I do it?
I mean, that's supposed to make you listen and tell me that you watched.
Well, if it were me, how would he be treated on the BBC? Or let me put it this way.
Would you like to have the BBC in this country?
Absolutely. I think the BBC is marvelous.
But the BBC is in this country.
Well, not enough. Not enough Americans
it. Leads me to my digital point.
Oh, yes, finally.
My digital point.
Yeah.
Okay. Your argument is that we have a agglomeration, which leads to less than fully reported content.
Yeah.
Right. Mm-hmm. But let me ask you before I, the digital point is this. Does that argument make any sense when we have digital television, which means for the viewers, today's cable television where you get 600 channels in some respects, and how about the internet?
Yeah.
Where it goes on forever and ever, and I guess we can even get Mark Crispin Miller on the internet.
We can indeed.
And why isn't that just as good as being on this show? Maybe it's better than.
I won't speak to that question because I don't know. But
you get the point, though.
I do get the point. I've heard this argument before, and there's some truth to it. I say God bless the internet. Well, I mean, it is a way for people to get a lot of information they're not going to get otherwise.
Right.
All the examples I gave you of stories about the war in Iraq come from the internet. I didn't go down to the corner and buy the Guardian.
So you go to the internet. You come on to this mass audience program. You tell what you've seen on the internet, and the viewers get it. Well, that's great. What's that got to do with conglomeration?
Well, plenty, and I'll tell you why. First of all, the two answers to this. The digital TV spectrum was handed over to the same big entities that are profiting from the old media. This was part of the 1996 telecom bill. So the digital TV spectrum, which would theoretically open up, you know, there'd be 100 flowers blooming right now.
Right.
There's like 5 flowers blooming,
right,
just as there are already. That's a serious problem, and I think a violation of the spirit of the public service requirements of the FCC. So the digital TV spectrum is actually not available to the general public. Second of all, the web is basically dominated by the same huge players that have the deep pockets to publicize their stuff.
Wait. Well, this argument I really have trouble with.
Why?
Let's go back. The other argument is you say that the big companies have control of the digital spectrum.
Mm-hmm.
I won't argue at great length with you about this, but I don't really see how that impacts the 600 channels which I have. I also have DirecTV, so add them all together. I got 1,000 channels, one of which is the famed BC to which you earlier referred. But anyway, let me have the last word on that and get to the internet. Your internet point is that even though we have all this variety of the internet, nonetheless it's dominated by the biggies?
It is dominated by the biggies. Well, first of all, some search engines will actually not permit you to go to some sites, like Go, for example, is the owner of Go. I hope I have this right. It might not be Go, but it's a Disney-owned search engine. You cannot visit certain anti-Disney sites via that engine.
Yeah, but you can use another.
But most people won't know that they can't get to it. Do you see what I'm saying? The problem here is that you don't know what you don't know. You may think you're, you know, happy as a clam. You've got the whole world at your fingertips because you have the 1,000 channels, because you have the internet.
Yeah.
But Jim, the point is that vast number, you know, the diversity there is often more apparent than real, because behind the 1,000 channels there might be a dozen owners. You see?
Yeah, I mean, I think that you might have more of an argument on 1,000 channels, but I must say I have difficulty with the argument.
Well, all right, let me just say this very quickly,
that
almost all the traffic on the internet goes to the sites that are owned by Viacom, by Bill Gates, and so on.
But that's not their fault.
The playing field is not level. Okay, it's not a level playing field. Believe me, I lecture, I do a lot of talk radio. Most Americans have no idea of the existence of a lot of terrific sites that they should know about.
Right.
And it's just because there's a tremendous inequity built into it. It's not just a virgin wilderness here. We're talking about parts of it that have been enormously developed by those who have this inordinate advantage. So all I'm saying to you, Jim, is that the internet is not a panacea. It is a great democratic resource, but it has to be protected, you know. It has to be kept open.
But it is open, isn't it?
Well,
I mean, what would you do? Let's put it this way. I mean, your argument is that the biggies attract more people because they have more money to publicize it. But also, whether you like it or not, they probably attract people because people like to go there. You know, so that's a difficult problem, because if the people want to go there and stay there rather than go on to the search engine and go someplace else, I have a little difficulty blaming the biggies for that.
You know, I'm not really into blame. This is a structural critique.
See, okay, obviously, it's still a criticism.
No, but I mean, I don't think that in a democracy you should have corporate powers that have such cultural clout.
Okay, so how would you fix it on the internet? I mean, I know how you can fix it elsewhere,
well,
but on the internet.
Well, it's all related. I don't think you can separate out the internet part of the problem by any means.
It's called the digital age.
Well, okay, that's true. but I have to say that, you know, one of the subtexts of the 1996 telecom, but one of the real purposes of it was to allow those companies to extract as much profit from the web as possible. That's what they were really interested in. Right. They want to see the conflation of your computer with your TV set, right? And that's one of the reasons why they were handed the digital TV spectrum.
All right, I'm going to have to cut you short.
Okay.
Because we've come to the end. Did the press and the digital press give George W. Bush a pass?
The digital press is still quite diverse. And if it includes the press abroad, then we can't say that they gave Bush a pass.
Right, okay.
The major American press, however, the old media press, and its digital offshoots, have given Bush a shocking free pass. They have basically functioned as his instrument, as his creature. It's not a democratic situation.
Mark Crispin Miller, thank you for such a non-controversial presentation. And thank you for joining us tonight, and come back next week to learn more about the digital age. For the digital age, I'm James Goodale.